Dear friends, dear couples, we are here for having another meditation today. We are going to meditate about the mercy of God and the mercy among us. So forgiveness of sins. And we are going to start with a prayer, asking the fire-reaching mercy that is God, the way St. Paul described him in Ephesians 2:4. We begin asking to help us to understand better his mercy for us, so we can be merciful and compassionate as our Father is merciful and compassionate. We pray to him. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. We ask Mary, Mother of Mercy, Mother of Jesus, that help us also to be merciful. She was merciful with those who were killing her son. So, it's a deep mercy and compassion, the heart of our Mother Mary. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and in the hour of our death. Amen. And understanding that the source of mercy is within you, within us, is the Holy Spirit. We are temples of God and we are called to glorify God through our lives. So through our love, we give glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. So we are going to have like two parts. First is understanding better the mercy of God. Because we are Christians, because we live from the mercy of God. The mercy of God is not a thinking, it's not an idea, it's not... No, the mercy of God is a person. It's Jesus Christ died on the cross and rise from the dead. That is the mercy of God. So all revelation of God from the Old Testament to the New Testament is a revelation of the mercy of God. The fulfillment of that revelation is his Son crucified. That is the mercy of God, giving his Son for me being a sinner. And he didn't give his Son for me being a good person. No, he died for our sins. And we repeated that action in every Eucharist. So it's something that is the essence of our salvation, the mercy of God. And in every Eucharist, we repeat the words, "This is my blood that is shed for the forgiveness, is poured out for the forgiveness of sins." So that is the mercy of God, is that God has a love that doesn't stop before the sin, before the evil, before the my disdain to him, my contempt of him, my anger with him. God continues loving us because God is love. And we are called to love as he loves us. But he loves us with mercy. So the first thing is understanding that mercy of God, and trying to open more my heart to that mercy. Because I need mercy. I more than you all do that. But you need mercy also. So because we need love. And in the human situation, in human history, the only way of receiving love is mercy. So, and God loved us in our weakness. He came, you know, there are several expressions of Jesus about this mercy. I will give you a lot of texts if you want to read them later in your meditation. But meditation is not so much reading. It's more learning to open your heart to God. So you are a temple of God and God is within you. All the readings these days of the gospel are repeating that. Remain in me and I in you. You remain in me and I in you. You will bear fruit in abundance. You are a temple of the Holy Spirit. And all the action of God depends on how we get aware of this presence of him in us. And because his presence is love and power, and it's not a passive presence, it's a powerful presence of God for healing our hearts and bringing us to love. The love and the fountain of love is only God. In the universe, there is not a real love out of God. Because the loves that we have habitually are emotional, feelings, affections, sexual thing, but they are not true love. True love, you have this definition of love, beautiful, of Saint John. In the first letter, chapter 3, verse 16. Jesus has taught us what is love. What? Giving himself to us. So giving his life to us until the cross. So we have to love each other as he loves us. You know, the commandment that Jesus given this day in the chapter 15 and 14 and 13 of Saint John. Love each other as I love you. But first we need to understand the love of God, because it's not a matter of, oh, I have to forgive. No, it's a matter of how we are opening to the love of God, to the grace of God, the action of God in our souls. If the things are very difficult, it's because my ego, myself, my own will remain keeping me there and is not opening to the will of God, to the love of God, to the power of God, to salvation. So, first statement here is, what is the mercy of God? Jesus crucified for my sins. And for love to me being a sinner. He died for us being sinners. He loved us being sinners. That is all the whole point here of salvation and the whole point of how we can become holy. Because only love heals our hearts from our sins. And we need to open to his love. And his love, because he's opening my sins to him, means that I have to open my misery to him. So my weakness, my poverty, my lack of love, my anger, my frustrations, my judgmental mind, my criticizing mind, my talks that are hurting the other person, and all these things, we need to open them to God, because he loves us. That is the central point of everything. You have two texts here that you can go there. One is Romans 5:5-6:10. It talk about how he died for us being sinners. And the other, Romans 5, chapter 5, verses 6 to 10. And the other, that is another powerful, amazing text, is Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. It's a powerful text about the mercy of God and how God loved us being sinners. You know, we know clearly the expression of Jesus in Matthew. That is, when Jesus said, I have not come to save those, the righteous, but the sinners. So in the moment I am thinking that I am righteous, I don't need God. I have come as a physician for the sick, not for the healthy. So every one of us is wounded, deeply wounded by original sin, that you know is a total self-centeredness. According to the Protestants, we are totally corrupted by original sin and cannot be healed. For us Catholics, the things are more balanced, and we think that we are wounded, but the grace of God can transform us and make us whole. So why? Because selfishness is ruling our behavior. That is original sin. It's my ego in the center of everything. But we were not created in that way. We were created from God, so from the love of God, in the love of God, his divine providence, and toward God. That is the way we were created. And Jesus came to restore the plan of the Father. So our God is the creator. We don't have two gods. It's only one. The one who created us in his Son eternally, he now wants to restore the things in the one he created us, his Son. And so the thing is learning to open to that mercy. Because we are in a society that from childhood is teaching us that we have to be perfect, we have to be wonderful, we have to be marvelous, and so we are creating a mind, and that is also for your children, please. And don't teach them that they have to be perfect, because they will focus on an external behavior. Because inside, all of us, as we know, are full of pride and vanity and anger and jealousy and lust. You go to your history and understand what is there happening. So, and where is perfection there? Nowhere. Why? because we are looking for love. Here, the core of the thing is understanding I need love. And I need love in whom I am. Not I need love for... I need love for loving others. I need love for loving my husband. I need love for loving my wife. I need love for being a patient, kind father, that a mother that brings my children to God. I need love. That is Christian life. Christian life is living from the love of God. And this is the whole thing. It's not that there are 1,000 more things. No, the other things are things that we do for learning to open to the love of God. The sacraments, the whatever thing in the church is done is for the grace of God, that you know. And the grace of God is the mercy of God in our hearts. And we need that mercy. Why? Because we are wounded. And you know the expression of St. Paul, God surrendered everyone in sin for having mercy of everyone. So nobody can boast of anything. This is all about the gift of God and the grace of God and the action of God. But we need for loving to open to his love. And that means to be a Christian is living from the love of God. Not trying to look for love outside. That is something I understand is a little difficult to get it. But this is the human problem. Of the root of all problems is that we are looking for love outside. We are not looking for love in God. When we were little, as your children, they are looking for love in you, as parents. Why? Very good. Why? Because you occupy the place of God. And you occupy the place of God for opening them to the mercy of God. Not for correcting them and punishing them and ruling them and being upset with them and angry and impatient with them. No, you are not there for that. You are there for opening them to the love of God. That is the reason in the psychological level, God has created them with a dependence, affective, emotional dependence on you. They need love, as you need love. The problem here is you have time until 12 for opening your children to the mercy of God, not to a kind of love that is weird. No, the mercy of God, I insist, has a name, it's here. This is the mercy of God. This is the mercy of God. Jesus Christ crucified. That is the mercy of God. This is an expression of Jean Paul II, a saint. Jean Paul II is not mine. Jesus is the incarnation and the personification of the mercy of God. He came to teach us mercy. I can go to a lot of tests. You can read Luke 4, 17-21, and you will see that Jesus is proclaiming the mercy of God with a text of the prophet Isaiah there. I'm not going to read because we have short time, and I want to do the things and go to the point here. So, here the first thing is understanding that I need mercy. If you understand that, you don't have any relationship with God. Me neither. I mean, and I need mercy every day. I need to open to the love of God for me. Because it's the only way of changing myself. We need love. And I insist, in the moment that we are talking about this attachment to children to you, God has given you that power for opening your children in the spiritual level to God. The psychological level is more the emotional feeling thing. The spiritual thing is that God is there and loves them with an infinite love that is his son crucified. So, and that they need that love. Because after 12, as you know, and you happen to you and happened to me, after 12, when puberty comes on, the sexual thing is developed, if we have not learned to open our hearts to the love of God, we are going to put the desire of being loved outside. And that is the root of all sins. And we need to keep it in God. So because now what our body is calling is not to find love outside. Our body is calling us to give ourselves in love to others. That is called spousal love. That is what is your marriage and is what your children will be called in the future. In a religious life, in a priesthood life, or in a marriage life. But our vocation, fundamental vocation, is love. Giving ourselves to others. But if we are not living from the love of God, that is, marriage becomes so difficult, so tough, as you better than me. Why? Because we need love. If we are not opening our hearts to the love of God, Jesus came to restore marriage. You know, the plan of God in Genesis 1:27 is marriage. Image and likeness of God creating them.
And image and likeness of God is male and female created then. That is the image and likeness of God, the relationship between a man and a woman. Why? Because in the Trinity, the person are totally a gift to other. The only one who is not receiving something in the Trinity is the Father. And the reason we need to become children of God, for receiving from the Father and now giving to others what we are receiving. Well, this person, listen, the first time Jesus sent the apostles to preach the gospel is give free what you are receiving free. Why? Because these are the grace of God. That is the reason St. Paul is always talking that we are saved by faith, not by works. It's not that we don't have to have works. No, it's that faith opened me to the love of God, opened me to the grace of God, to the action of God in my soul, to the Holy Spirit who is indwelling in me from baptism, as you know. I mean, we receive a person of the divine Trinity, Holy Trinity, that is infinite love, because he's a divine person. He's the love between the Father and the Son, and has been given to us in possession. I mean, the fact that we don't pay attention to this thing, because we are always looking for love outside. In Facebook, in Instagram, in TV, in my children, in my husband, and you are not going to find love. I need to open to the love of God. And I open to the love of God in a process that is called humility. Because it's knowing myself. Because I can open to the mercy of God, what? What is the object of mercy? My misery? If you read Santa Teresa of the Child Jesus, you will see that it's all about that. Why? Because I boast of my weakness before God, so the power of God can be in me. I can do everything with the one who comes for me. But at the same time, I understand that my weakness is my power before God. As your power before a sick person, the power of a sick person before the physician, what is? If I have a little wound that nobody can see, the physician will say to me, the doctor, okay, come later. But if I am bleeding, I mean, the doctor will take care of me immediately. So our sins are not a problem for God. Our lives are a problem for God. And the second dimension is imagine a poor person. I mean, if I am with a Rolex and dressed with a tuxedo with diamonds and whatever, I don't know. I mean, do you think that I ask for money, somebody is going to give me something? But if I am a poor person, that I am with starvation and I'm my belly is swell, I mean, I ask for money and everyone will give me. So our power before God is not our goodness, it's our poverty. It's our weakness. It's a process of humility that, you know, God exalts the humble and disdains the prideful. The point of the desire of being loved is that generate pride. Because if I want to be loved, I cannot be weak. I have to be perfect. Because if not, how they are going to love me if I am not perfect? So imagine the problem. And now vanity. Why? Because I need that the other love me, appreciate me, know me, recognize me, value me, and think that I am the best. That is called vanity. Now envy. Why? Because I want the other to, the woman or that family has that I don't have, and they're going to be more famous or better. It's all envy. It's all about the other person are going to be loved more than me, or they're having something that I would want to have. I mean, I can go to war. Lust is always there also. It's the desire of being loved by other people that are not my wife or are not my husband. And that desire and all these things are there in every human heart. In the moment the desire of being loved is not in God, it's outside. Nobody can control this because we are created. So created means our being, our senses, our mind, our head, our body, our soul, our spirit. Everything is created in us for living from love. That is what means childhood. We need love. When a person is not receiving love in childhood, has problems of identity. And that can be healed how? Opening to the love of God. That is the only way God can heal people. Why? Because it's a lack of love of the parents. And because the parents are not loving me, my identity, I want to be other identity. So it's a huge, deep problem. But salvation is coming to the love of God. I cannot come to the love of God with my weakness every day. Yes, that is the point. Your weakness is your power before God. Your sinfulness is your power before God. Your sins are your power before God. I gave you the two texts there. I have to go quickly. That hears. So, what is mercy? Mercy is that God loves more. Take this. God loves more the poor, the little, those who don't deserve it.
It's like a mother, no?
There was a mother who had 7 children. What of your children do you love more? Was asking in an interview. No, all the same. You cannot love all the same. You have more sympathetic with one of them, and more that is more your temperament, or a girl's, or... No, I love all the same. Of course, I love them different because they are different persons. But in intensity, I love all the same. So that cannot happen. And at the end, the mother, tired of the host making the interview, say, okay, yeah, you have the reason. I love all the same. I love more the one who is out of home when he's out of home, and the one who is sick when he's sick. That is mercy. It's the love of God for those who are away from him and for those who are sick, because they are destroying themselves because of their sins. And this is very important. It's the core of salvation. And now we need, you know, you have the beautiful chapter 15 of St. John. It's more in the chapter 15 of St. Luke. Luke 15. Okay? So, 1:5. There you have 3 parables about mercy. Amazing. And I'm going to read them to you because you know them and you can go and meditate there. And the 3 finish with the same thing. It's more joy in heaven for one sinner that turned to God to convert than 99 liars that don't need conversion. The liars is something I am adding, but it's obviously that is what is presupposed there. Why? Because 99 guys who doesn't need conversion are 99 Pharisees. Because, you know, Jesus faced very strongly the Pharisees. Why? Because they think that they were perfect. And Jesus was always with sinners. And they accused even of that to him. So you have the... I want a text that is Matthew 9:12-13. That is when Jesus defined also his mission of bringing mercy. Matthew 9:12-13. So, I'm going to give you some text because, so we receive mercy for giving mercy. Mercy is not when the other person is good. No. For that you don't need mercy. I need mercy when the other person is not acting according to what I think he must treat me. When I am offended by the other person. And that is in marriage, as you can understand, without this, it's impossible to love in a marriage. Why? Because your husband, your wife is failing every day. As I fail every day, every human being is weak. But I don't stop loving. I continue loving because I have the love of God. And see, this is not about an effort that you have to do. In the moment that you think about an effort, it's because me or you, we don't have any relationship with God. This is about opening to the Holy Spirit and letting God to be my God and be my Father. And let him, his power that is within me, to give me his grace so I can love as he loves me. And that is the whole of the thing. I mean, a marriage without mercy become destroyed. And people stop loving each other because they are accumulating the hatred, resentment, grudges. He did that, she did that. I mean, and now the things are growing. And now my affective level is going away from the other person. Why? Because it's touching my affectivity and I'm not restoring it through love. Through what love? The love of God within you. Marriage cannot work. It's impossible. You are called to holiness to marriage. But your holiness is the way of love. And the only way of loving a person in this world is mercy. And the same with your children. I mean, mercy is the key of everything because we are wounded. And God put us in that wound and let that happen for teaching us what is his amazing love and power working in our hearts when we open to him in faith. Because that's the mystery of faith, is that I can open to the power and the love of God for me, so I can now try to love others. All spiritual life is trying to open to the love of God. Because if I'm not opening to the love of God, I don't love anyone. I have affections, I have emotions, I have attachments, but it's all about my ego. Only when I stop my egocentric behavior, that is about my desire of being loved, egocentric behavior is not thinking that I am the center of the universe. We are not so stupid. Maybe sometimes, but usually, is the desire of being loved, so ruling my will, and now in relationship with others. And that is the reason we are controllers, that is the reason we are nagging other people, that is the reason we are possessive, that is the reason we get upset and angry with this person because he's doing. Why? Because we are not living from the love of God. And the desire of being loved has to be necessarily in God or outside, because that desire that you don't control. And it's connected with the desire of happiness. I mean, if you put your happiness, your desire of being loved in God, you can put your happiness in God. If I am not putting my desire of being loved in God, neither my happiness is in God, so I don't have any charity. Because charity is loving God with all my heart, all my strength, all my being, and all my soul. Why? Because only in Him is happiness. So the thing is understanding that be compassionate as your Father is compassionate. But the key is not the expression be compassionate, is your Father is compassionate with you. If I am living from the mercy of God, how am I going to forgive others? If I know my weakness clearly every day for loving, and how I am living in my head complaining and grumbling and judging and criticizing, I mean, with a lack, deep lack of love, and the only way you stop that is you or me opening to the mercy of God and saying, my God, I need you, please help me to be loved, more loving and more kind, and remain in the present moment in your love. Remain in my love. Remain in my love. I mean, that is whole Christian life, remaining in the love of God. But if I am not remaining in the love of God, my desire of being loved is coming out, and that is the root of all sins. So it's giving love to the person, even if he don't deserve it. Yes, that is what God is doing with me every day. Even I don't deserve his love, he continues loving me. I'm showing me his love. If I open to him, of course, because it's a matter of faith. And that can heal. Only love heals our hearts. So if my husband or my wife is doing something wrong and I criticize him, I get grudges, I get resentment, he is not going to change ever. The only way of bringing her, him, to his dignity is loving him. But how am I going to do that? You can't. It's the love of Jesus who can do that in you. Remain in my love. And now he's given the commandment. What commandment? You know, we are reading it these days, John 15. You can read that chapter. Love each other as I love you. But this as I love you is not a thinking. It's a way of living from the love of God. Yeah. And we need to work that. Text. I give some text so you can. Psalm 51. Well, we talk about Luke 15, have three parables. One is the lost sheep. How Jesus is looking for you when you sin. I mean, and he's looking for you with love, with tenderness, for carrying you on his shoulders. And the other is the drachma, the woman who lost the coin and he was looking for her, and the joy when she found it. And God is always talking about a sinner and how God is before sinners. And the third is the prodigal son, that is the big sinner, and the other who thinks that is good, that is the worst. In my opinion, the second son is worse than the prodigal son. I mean, he's envious, has no love to his dad, has no love to his brother, is aggressive, is a monster. And he was thinking, I always obey you, I am the good guy. I mean, Jesus is talking about the Pharisees. You read the text, you will see that. So, other text, Matthew 5:43-48. Matthew 9:10-12. I talked about that text before. Matthew 18:21-35. John 8. Matthew 18:21-35. That is a powerful text. I mean, it's a parable of Jesus. He finished in the same. When Jesus taught us to pray to our Father, he only repeated one thing. He can't repeat the whole Our Father, no, or several things. No, only one. I say to you, if you don't forgive from your heart, neither your Father will forgive you. And in this parable 18, he repeated exactly the same thing. Because if I don't forgive, I cannot be with God. God is love. And he is the one who is the source of love in your life and in your marriage. And that is the reason we need to pray. We don't pray for saying things because he knows everything eternally. We pray because we need his love. We need to let his love to transform our hearts. Because I don't have that love for loving a person when he's not treating me well. Eh? But God has that love, as Mary shows in the Passion, as Jesus shows in the Passion. They are all then opening to the love of God, to the Holy Spirit, so they can love in the worst situation and continue loving. Because you, as me, mature through love. So if we are not opening to the love of God, boom, I am blocked to love others and I am not mature and I don't grow. And I say this is very important because what you have to teach your children is mercy. So you're not living a relationship with this founded in mercy, nothing works. That means that we are in 9:30, so I have to finish. Okay, I give you some text. Take this. Romans 1:17. Romans, and letter of the Romans, 3:10:31. Romans 4:22-24. Luke 1:46-55. I mean, you can read all Isaiah 55. Powerful text about this. I mean, there are a lot of texts about the mercy of God. So try to open your heart to Jesus came to bring mercy to this world. Because science is a marriage cannot work without mercy. It's impossible. And the mercy means that I forgive from my heart. So I don't keep the things. I don't bring them back 1 year later or 5 years later saying to the person, you did that. I mean, that is totally a person who has no relationship with God. I mean, mercy is forgiving. Why? Because I am living from the love of God. I am not looking for love in others. I am looking for maturing, growing, having virtues, and coming to the union with God. And when I am there, I can love others because I am living from His love. When I am looking for my own egocentric feelings, emotions, and my whatever way of thinking about me that is not in God, through God and for God, I mean, in that case, things are almost impossible. Mercy is the only way of maturing and growing in love. That is the same as forgiveness. It's forgiving how many times I have to forgive my neighbor? 17 times 7. What means always. And if your brother come to you and ask you for forgiveness, how many times he come, forgive him. Mercy is the key of everything in the spiritual life. And in a relationship, in my relationship with God, but also in my relationship with my brothers and sisters. Because if not, I become judgmental. Because they are failing as I am failing every day. We as Mary, we give us that. We pray to her, Mother of Mercy, Refuge of Sinners. We have a lot of titles that have reference to that mystery of Mary as a merciful woman. Try to grow there because it's the only way of growing in love. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and in the hour of our death. Amen. I'm reminded that we are temples of God. Everything I say is not your effort. No, it's you letting God to be God in your heart. So the source and fountain of love to rule my heart. With glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Okay, thank you. Be merciful with me also. Thank you.